Hello everyone, this is Craig Fitch with Oculus. Welcome to another Oculus webinar. We certainly thank you for attending this webinar, the Sequant Stray Light Meter Functional Cataract Quantification and Scatter Assessment. Our speaker is Dr. Tom Vandenberg. Dr. Tom Vandenberg has been heading the physics department for the Netherlands Ophthalmic Research Institute, now merged into the Netherlands Institute for Neuroscience of the Royal Academy. About half of his 200 SCI publications concern the optics of the human eye, in particular light scattering. He designed a method to assess clinically the functional effort of scatter called stray light as the basis of significant patient complaints such as glare, face recognition difficulties, hazy vision, etc. This method has been implemented by Oculus in the Sequant Stray Light Meter. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have any questions throughout this webinar, this is a pre-recorded webinar, so please email myself or Dr. Vandenberg at the email below, and we will be more than happy to answer these questions. I will give you my emails more towards the end of the webinar. So without further delay, please welcome Dr. Tom Vandenberg.
Thank you, Craig, for this nice introduction. It's a great pleasure for me to give this webinar. As you will see, I'm a physicist, and much of my scientific career has been devoted to the optics of the eye, in particular the light scattering processes. And I always have wanted to understand this, to understand patient complaints about this phenomenon in the eye, and how to make it accessible for clinical testing. And in the end, I was successful, and Oculus was very successful in making that method into a very good instrument. Now, by way of introduction and synopsis, I have a few slides. Our eye suffers from forward light scatter. That forward light scatter degrades vision. If forward light scatter increases, significant patient complaints may result. The typical complaint is glare, but also includes hazy vision, face recognition problems, spatial orientation problems, and much more difficult, different problems, and different patients may voice those problems differently. Well, here are some pictures to have some idea about forward light scattering in the eye. Normally, light should be projected in a straight line to a point on the retina, but because of impurities in our eyes, part of the light is scattered all around towards the retina, degrading vision. This light scattering is very different from visual acuity problems. Most often, the increase in forward light scatter is caused by early cataract, but other disturbances to the optical media may be important also, such as corneal dystrophies, vitreous opacity, PCO, IOL impurities, etc. Forward light scatter leads to false light projected over the retinal image. Everybody can visualize this by looking at the bright point of light against the dark background. This false light is called stray light, and the strength of this light is the elementary parameter to quantify the problem. So it is this strength of light, as you see it, as your patient sees it, as compared to what is normal. That is the parameter of importance, this intensity. So forward light scatter leads to stray light, and stray light is the name for the visual effect that we see of light spreading. And it serves as an additional quality of vision parameter. In ophthalmology and optometry, of course, visual acuity is the most important parameter. But as I will show you, stray light is second important, is also very important. And in some cases, it is the most important problem of your patient. Stray light, as compared to visual acuity, is an independent parameter. You can have patients that have significant complaints from stray light without having visual acuity loss. But the reverse can also be the case. The intensity, that's this value here, can be determined as an exact value, like it was real light, like we could measure it as real light. But it is a visual phenomenon. Please realize that. So it's a functional measure. And the Oculus Sequent instrument does a perfect job of measuring this stray light value in the patient's eye. So it's a functional value for quantifying cataract or other disturbances that can scatter light. The test has 1.5 minute duration. It's objective, which means it cannot be influenced. And, which is very important, it has a reliability to it. It will give you a value for its reliability, and I will show you that that is very good. There are many papers about this instrument. There are introductory papers, official literature, and a survey of the official literature, all of which can be found at my website. Good introductory paper is an encyclopedia chapter, and of course the survey of all the literature up till the half of 2012 is an important source of information about all the different clinical studies that have been done. This is the content of the webinar. I will start with some basics explaining the process that leads from light scatter to stray light to complaints and the importance of stray light for visual function. Part 2. I will summarize a great many studies on stray light in cataract, cornea, vitreous, PCO, IOL, and occupational glare testing. And at the end, I will do a rather simple instructional phase on the sequence. Let me compare in somewhat more detail the essential difference between stray light and visual acuity. I've shown this before. This is the effect of stray light. But now, where is the effect of visual acuity in this picture? And for that, we need to focus in detail to very small parts of the image, and I just take this part where this light source is, and if we enlarge that and enlarge that further, then we will see the light spreading from refractile errors called aberrometry that is important for visual acuity. So for visual acuity, the light spreading over these distances is important. But that is light spreading over a very minute area. And of course, if we have a visual acuity chart, if the light spreads just a little bit like this, over a very small distance, then that is the result, and visual acuity will be lost. But you can now directly understand that the effects, the spreading effects of visual acuity as compared to the light spreading effects of stray light are an enormous way apart. And to make this a little bit more scientific, this light spreading in the human eye is called the point spread function. This is the standard for healthy eyes of our point spread function in our eyes. And if I add to this the part of the point spread function that dominates over visible acuity, it's only this part, it's a very minute but very important part of the point spread function. And if I further add a little bit more of the point spread function, this is important for contrast sensitivity. But again, it's a very small central part of the point spread function. And if I add the area where stray light comes into play, we see that it is a huge area where stray light is the dominating part. It's a part of much lower intensity. You can see that along this scale. But because it has such an enormous size, it is still functionally very important, depending on the type of problem the patient may be having. Now, in order to show you what kind of vision your patient has if he suffers from stray light, we made simulations based on our knowledge of this point spread function for typical early cataract cases. The first case is for the signs in our institute. The signs in our institute are, well, I would say, not very nicely designed for an institute, an ophthalmological institute, where many patients need to find their way. But well, this is how it is in our elevator. And for the average normal eye, this is more or less visible. But if visual acuity goes down, well, it is still rather visible. But if stray light goes down by a factor of 2, which is quite normal in the population, this is the effect on visibility. And you can understand that the patient may complain from hazy vision. Another important aspect, especially for elderly people, is face recognition. The average normal eye may see my face like this. If visual acuity is down, not much happens to the visibility of my face. But with increased stray light, and this now is the unit that we use for increased stray light, and this value is a value that is also happening often in early cataracts, it's very difficult to recognize properly the facial expression, and a real problem for an elderly patient. And this then is the more typical example, the problem of driving at night. In this scene, you will see here a pedestrian clearly visible for the average normal eye. With visual acuity down, the pedestrian is still very well visible. Only the signs in the background can no longer be read. That is why visual acuity is important for driving, that you can no longer read the signs. But for general orientation, visual acuity is not so important. But stray light is very important, and this pedestrian can be missed. Now, how do we measure stray light? Well, the way to do that is to establish identity between the observed light, this is the observed light or that, depending on your eye, and a reference light of known value. And this comparison is being made using what we call psychophysics, a scientific technique to do observational studies. And this has been entered into the oculus sequel. The patient will see this in the instrument, a ring of flickering light, and in the middle, two half fields. And in one of these half fields, he will see his own stray light in a flickering fashion. And in the other half field, he will see a comparison light. and the task of the patient is to push the knobs on the side that flickers strongest. His stray light value or his comparison value. And if we make a series of small comparisons between his stray light and a light of known value, you may understand that it will be easy to deduct to conclude the precise value of his stray light. So, it is a functional value because it's really light as being seen by the patient, and it's quantified this, well, this parameter, the stray light parameter, as given logarithmically, so that it can be compared in scale to visible acuity. The test duration is 1.5 minutes. It's an objective measurement, and there is an assessment of reliability. And now, as a first example of this measurement, I will present Mrs. W., age 72, with severe complaints of hazy vision. Her complaints weren't that clear, not so much from visual acuity. Reading was not so much the problem, but she had very hazy vision, and that is how she came to the clinic. It is a bit an extreme example, but it shows a few nice aspects of the stray light measurement. And then we did the measurement with the Oculus Sequant system. This was the result. So this is the screen of the Oculus Sequant, and you will see that her value, her stray light value, is very high compared to what is normal in human eyes. Well, this curve of normality, you will see that for young eyes, stray light is low, but, and this is a curve for, let's say, best eyes, relatively good eyes, this curve goes up. And the reason why this goes up, of course, is because the lens, the human crystalline lens, ages and scatters more with age. But in the case of this patient, there was an enormous amount of light being scattered, and this is really a very bad value. So it was completely clear that she had complaints. But the reason was also very clear. There was a very clear deposit on her IOL. I show this because it also illustrates the kind of precision of this measurement. And you can see that you can differentiate very well many different levels of stray light. After 1 month, this patient came back because it was hoped that maybe the problem would resolve itself, but it did not. And you must see how reproducible the measurement is. See, almost identically the same value, with the error bars again showing how precise this works. And the decision was made for an IOL exchange. And upon the IOL exchange, stray light improved a lot. But I show this example because we had a unique situation here. We now had in our hands the reason for the increased stray light level. And we could now, and this was a unique opportunity, compare the value from the lens in our hands to the value given to us by this patient. And the value was here. By this patient, by pushing these knobs, by doing this test. And so, we put this lens into a setup where we can measure light scattering. The setup really looks like, you could say, like an eye. This camera is in the position of the retina, let's say, can move around. and can measure the complete point spread function from scattered light as being scattered by the explanted IOL. And after this measurement, in vitro measurement, we could compare the result with what this patient had given us in the clinic. And this is the comparison. The in vitro result is the blue line here, and the result this patient gave us in the clinic of the red dot. And you can see what a perfect and accurate result this is. Now, what causes stray light in the eye? What are the processes that are important? And I will show you an example for the aging eye lens and cataract formation, but of course the same questions are valid for all the other potential sources of light scattering in the eye. And for this, to explain a little bit, I show you what are normal slit lamp images. You will see in the slit lamp image a diffuse lightness, whereas in the young eye there is darkness. Well, diffuse lightness to the physicist means immediately that we have what we call small particle light scattering. It's an area filled with many thousands of small particles, and each of those small particles, they are too small to be seen, scatter light. This phenomenon is comparable to clouds or the blue of the sky. The blue of the sky is because of molecules scattering light. The clouds of the sky are seen because of the water droplets. But in the slit lamp, what you see is backward light scattering. And the question is, in the frontal direction towards the retina, might the same situation happen? Might the retina see, as it were, the eye lens more or less in the same way as you would see it with the slit lamp, also as a diffuse light scattering structure? But in the slit lamp you see backward scatter, and it is very different from forward scatter. So we needed to do this measurement. And so we extracted eye lenses from donor eyes, put it in this setup, and measured with the camera again the light being scattered. And from physics, we know there is a very precise correspondence between the light being scattered and the physical parts, the particles that do the scattering. So if you measure the light being scattered, you can predict the particles, and the other way around. If you know the particles, you can calculate the light scattering. And this is what we did. And I will show you the result compared to our normal point spread function. And remember, this point spread function is the in vivo point spread function. It's the value that I showed you earlier, the CIE standard form for the human eye for the in vivo point spread function as seen by our eyes. And you see how close the correspondence is between this in vitro optical measurement of light scattering and its interpretation as small particle scattering to this part of the point spread function, which makes it very clear that stray light derives from small particle light scattering. In the center, that's a completely different story. In the center, it's the aberration structure of the eye. It is the irregularities in the refractile structure of our eye lens and cornea. This is dominating in the central part, and light scattering by small particles is dominating in the periphery and causes stray light. In this study, we also had a rather cataractous lens, who scattered much stronger. And the result of that measurement was this green line. And you will see that again here in the periphery, there is an enormous elevation of the intensity of light. So this would be a patient like this. Instead, the other patient would have little light scattering. Now, it is clear that light scattering can be important and stray light can be important, but those are just examples. And is this important enough to really treat? And how would we evaluate importance of stray light? And this is a difficult question, but the question can be answered in some way by comparing its importance to visual acuity. Because in ophthalmology and optometry, visual acuity is, well, is the standard for quality of vision. And so we ask ourselves, how important is stray light as compared to visual acuity according to patient's daily experience? And for that, we used a questionnaire study in early cataracts. These are very well-known questionnaires, and we added a small questionnaire of our own. And the typical questions in such a questionnaire is this: how difficult is it to read a newspaper? And you can imagine that this may be more important for visual acuity. But how difficult is it to judge facial expression because of your vision? May be more of a stray light problem, etc. And all those questions in the questionnaire together give an impression of the importance of the quality of vision for daily living. And the results of this study is shown here. If we compare the outcome of the questionnaire to stray light, there is some correlation. If we compare the outcome to visual acuity, there is some correlation. But only if we combine stray light and visual acuity in an approximate one-to-one fashion, you will see that the explanation, the correlation with the questionnaire is optimal. Well, to be precise, visual acuity is more important to explain the questionnaire. But you can see that stray light is close. It's close to a one-to-one relation. And the conclusion of the study is that if we want to have a valid means of quality of vision of the problem of your patient, you should add visual acuity and stray light in approximate one-to-one fashion. Part 2, about the clinical studies that have been performed. First, the most important one is lens aging and cataract. And this is, of course, about adding stray light to quality of vision assessment, to visual acuity as the more dominant one, but what happens if we add stray light. This picture shows you the increase of stray light with aging that I also showed before. And you can see there is a very clear increase with aging, but the increase is very variable. So some eye lenses age much earlier than other eye lenses. And you can see that a 4 times increase happens quite often. And we have here a limit value that we have called serious visual handicap. It was based on this study. It was a study of European drivers where the patients in the study said to stop driving at night. That was at this limit. And we call that a serious visual handicap. If you stop driving at night is important for your mobility. And so we said, well, let's have that as a limit value. But maybe the same patients also have problems with visual acuity. So let's have a look at that. Here you see the same population, and here is the area of good visual acuity. And you will see that stray light varies enormously. For the whole of this curve, you can see that there is very limited relationship between stray light and visual acuity. And from what I told you earlier, you can maybe understand that a little bit. Visual acuity is dominated by refractile problems, refractile irregularities. Stray light is dominated by light scattering. Those are completely different processes in the eye. So that they occur independently in the population, they seem logical. And now if we consider patients below this line, so that they are no longer allowed to drive, you will see that there are 30 points here. And if we look at the limit line for safe driving at night, you will see there are 99 points above that. And the conclusion is that if you want to treat patients for their limits for safe driving, you would treat 30 on the basis of visual acuity, but 99 on the basis of stray light. But of course, there are differences in this plot, because here are people with extremely good visual acuity but bad stray light. And you would not want to treat that. So you really would like to use a trade-off between visual acuity and stray light. And this is the trade-off line. You would treat people above this line for a certain value of overall vision. Now, if you want to treat your patients also on the basis of stray light, then it must be so that stray light really improves upon cataract surgery. And what do we know about that? Here you see a small study where you clearly see a much improved stray light levels upon cataract surgery. And in this small study, the improvement factor was 3.24, whereas the visual acuity improvement factor was 1.74. And if we add a larger study, this was the limit value 1.4 of stray light, where you had 95% improvements in those 309 cataract surgeries. So what we proposed was maybe use this value as a kind of limit value to be able to tell your patient that cataract surgery will help. But if we do it more subtle and use the combination of visual acuity and stray light, then this is the improvement characteristic for this combined value. And if you would like to have a three lines improvement of your surgery, then this would be the limit value that you would use for this combined measure of visual acuity and stray light. To summarize this part about cataract, it's very clear that 20/20 vision is not enough. There are two aspects of quality of vision: the visual acuity or aberrometric domain and the stray light domain that must be added. Much more patients are eligible for cataract surgery if stray light is taken into account, and these are some criteria one might want to use. Cornea. This is just an example of one patient with Fuchs dystrophy, and after the surgery he had clearly improved his stray light value and you had a happy patient. This is a study combined between Amsterdam and the Mayo Clinic in the United States on a population of Fuchs patients. And these curves here show that especially for the younger eyes, stray light is more of the problem in phakic eyes as well as in pseudophakic eyes. And the conclusion of the study was that for younger patients, the problem is more from stray light, and in the older patients, the problem is more from visual acuity. But there are, of course, many, many more cornea problems that can be considered as potential problems of stray light. And many studies have appeared, and especially crystalline corneal dystrophy showed that stray light was enormously important here, whereas visual acuity was barely important. And for this corneal dystrophy, it was the reverse. Stray light was not important, but only visual acuity. For this corneal dystrophy, stray light was moderately important, not very. For Fuchs dystrophy, it is rather important. For keratoconus, it was more or less neutral. There is a lot of contact lens in studies that have shown variable results. Not all the studies showed the same effects, so it's not completely clear what's the case there. And in the case of contact lens induced edema, again, stray light is the major problem. This is of course much to treat here, but please refer to the literature. So, summary, cornea. In corneal dystrophies, stray light is often the major problem, and you can have happy patients after keratoplasty, also when visual acuity is not much improved. The vitreous. Again, an example of a patient that improved a lot after vitrectomy, in this case. Vitrectomy is a bit of a problem area. Not everybody likes to do that. It's a little bit tricky. But then it is needed that those subjective complaints of those patients are substantiated. And stray light can help to do that. And this was a study where it was shown that floater patients may suffer from very high stray light levels. These are very, very high levels here above. Those levels are very high. And the same study showed that vitrectomy is very effective as a remedy. So, summary for the vitreous, complaints from vitreous turbidity are in many cases quantifiable as extreme stray light levels. Pseudophakia. Well, I will especially go into problems that may be caused by the IOL and the PCO. Here you see this, the round circles, the results from pseudophakic eyes in this large population study that we did among drivers. And you will see that compared to the no cataract group, the red dots, many pseudophakic patients are much better off. These are kind of super eyes, let's say. They are below the best, they are better than the best eyes of their age. And of course, you would expect that if you take out the lens and you place an IOL, that then you will have a super eye. But then you would expect a level like this for all those eyes, and that is not the case. And a big question at this moment is, how come that you have so much stray light elevations from possibly the inserted IOL? I would like to remind you, this group was no PCO. So the only thing could be from IOLs. And this is being receiving much interest at present, to see the effects of IOLs on stray light. I showed you already this example, but of course this was an extreme example, but there are much more subtle examples also, and I cannot go into the detail, but for example, in the case of diffractive multifocals, they scatter light. Glistenings, they scatter light. Superficial calcifications, they scatter light. And in these studies, these are the stray light results, but this is only preliminary data at present, and a lot of studies on IOLs are taking place. But of course, in pseudophakia, a very important source of stray light is PCO. And it has been found that for the early forms of PCO, with the EPCO score below 1.5, the patient complaints are mainly from stray light, no visual acuity effects. Only later, when PCO further develops, visual acuity comes in as the more important effect. So in conclusion, from pseudophakia, PCO at early stages, mainly stray light elevation, and the IOLs, a lot of study is going on and must be done to clarify the stray light elevation effects of IOLs in pseudophakia. The last part of this clinical section is about occupational glare testing. As I mentioned, there is an international standard from the CIE that the glare effect is caused by stray light. And the correspondence between glare sensitivity and stray light is such that it was decided that as official standard for glare testing, the stray light value must be used. And please realize, stray light is a very precise and quantitative measure. It's part of the point spread function, which is a physically well-defined function. Now, the demands for pilots is that glare sensitivity is normal. So that must be tested by measuring stray light. Here is an example, again, of a patient, and this patient was a pilot, and he had his eyes done with LASIK, visual acuity was perfect, so it was said to him, well, the result is perfect, why complain, but he still complained, and it proved that his stray light level was 3 times increased. And then the question was, how important is that? That stray light is 3 times increased. And we compared his stray light level to what is normal in the eye. And then the conclusion must be that his eye aged to 80 years of age. And of course, you would not want a pilot with that kind of glare sensitivity. A few studies have occurred on occupational glare testing. First, please realize that Straylight is the official standard for glare testing. As limit value for pilots, it was proposed to use an increase of a factor of 2. And for glare testing for other less demanding occupations, such as drivers, it is proposed that Straylight is maybe 4 times increased. Now, at the end of this webinar, I would like to just go over a few simple things of use of the Sequant instrument. More details, please look at the practical guide. This is the screen of the Sequant, and at the screen, after you have entered the data of the patient, you have several things that you can set. The eye, of course, and here it says instruction phase, here it says automatic, here it says simulate, here it says range. To start with range, if you push that knob, then you will see that you can make a choice for very low Straylight or for very high Straylight. Well, it is so that for the average ophthalmological patient, let's say 95%, the default E range is okay. Most patients, it's good. But if you have a study on very clear young eyes, please use C instead. If you have a study on very bad eyes, please use G instead. And for this moment, we will use F for a clear-cut cataract. Next, you will set left-right eye. You can set the correction, but for this moment, we will assume no correction needed. And you must make a decision about the instruction phase. The instruction phase is really part of the test. It's the first part of the test to customize your patient. Well, in practice, we seldomly use this. But of course, you are free, and please make your own choice. But for the moment, we will have this button off. Then you need to explain the test to your patient. And for this, you can use this simulate button. And if you push that, then you will see this, and you can show on screen to the patient what he will see and must do in the setup, in the test. And you can tell him that he will see a flickering ring, and in the center, 2 half fields that also flicker, and it is his task to, with the push buttons, give the side that flickers strongest. And please remember, on one side the patient will see his own Straylight, the other side is the comparison light. And so, the instruction to the patient is, please disregard the flickering ring and focus only on the 2 weakly flickering half fields in the center. There will be a series of short stimulus presentations. Indicate with the push buttons the side that flickers strongest and do that directly, within a second, say. If you are uncertain the side that flickers strongest, please guess. Guessing is good here. Guessing is okay. There is no problem. You cannot do it wrongly. So please just guess and give us your response within a second or so. Then you can seat your patient. The height of the instrument can be adjusted. You can insert a correction for far or for 1 meter. It need not be precise. A 1 diopter error can easily be tolerated. The eye must be close to the instrument. It must not be pushed into the instrument. It must not be far away. It must not be squeezed. The other eye is best patched. And then the measurement can start. And you will say, this is not a very nice demonstration, but in reality, you will see the flicker appearing. And as soon as the flicker appears, you will say to your patient, please push. And then the patient will give his response. And for the next, you will say, please push. And the patient will give his response. And it continues like that. And then you will say, this is easy. This first few stimuli are easy. But slowly it will become more difficult. And then please continue like this, but by guessing the site that flickers strongest. And if the patient does that just by guessing the site that flickers strongest, you will have this series of measurements and you will see that the accuracy increases when more stimuli are presented. And slowly we will have even more accuracy and more, and at the end we will have this result with a perfect accuracy. If you have questions, please do not hesitate to contact me or Craig or visit my website.
Dr. Vanderbrand, thank you very much. On behalf of Oculus and the attendees, we thank you very much for your time and educational webinar you have shared with us. We look forward to working with you again in the near future.
Okay, you're quite welcome.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for attending another great educational webinar by Oculus. And Dr. Vandenberg, please keep watching your emails and Oculus website for other educational webinars on different instruments and topics. This webinar has been recorded and will be posted on the Oculus website very soon. The Oculus website is www.oculususa.com. And if you need to contact myself, Craig Fitch, please contact me at C as in Charlie, F as in Frank, I, T for Tommy, CH, at oculususa.com. Thank you very much and have a good day.